Today, I'm gonna show you how to make and color and apply Terra Sigillata in an easy way. So, what is Terra Sigillata? It is a very, very thin particle clay dissolved in water that you apply to pots that you don't intend to glaze the normal way to get a shine. So I use it for, and I guess that's what most people do, I use it for things like a naked raku. So this pot have no glaze, it's just the pot and the Terra Sigillata and then the naked raku slip that I take off. I also use it a lot for pit fire to achieve this almost glazed-like surface. It's not glazed, it's just the clay and the Terra Sigillata and then it's burnished afterwards with the wax. I also sometimes use it for pit fried bowls like this, although you're not supposed to use low-fired pots and pit fried pots like this for food. I still use them for oranges or bananas and things that are not too sensitive. I would not put soup or salad in that, but something with a peel, I think that should be okay. Anyway, let's get on with it. There's probably as many different ways to do Terra Sigillata as potters out there. What I will show you is a way that I found to work well for my pots, and that is relatively easy to do. But keep in mind, you may not have the exact same materials. You may want to experiment with other kinds of clays and other kinds of deflucants, but this is how it worked for me, and so let's go on with it. You need a few things to do this Terra Sigillata. First of all, of course, you need some sort of clay. I like to use clay that is already pulverized or powdered. I use ball clay. This is a standard ball clay that I get from my local supplier here in Denmark. There's all kinds of ball clay. I think most of it can be used. Some people use red art and other kinds of clay. Even scraps, dried scraps from your trimmings can be used if you break them down into powder. Anyway, not all kinds of clay apparently turn out great Terra Sigillata. I can't give you a list of everything that works and what doesn't, but at least the ball clay works fine for me. Then you need a bottle. I like to use a glass bottle where you can watch how it's dissolved and how it settles. I picked up this, I think it's from IKEA or something, very cheap. If you go to a flea market or something, you can find lots of this. I usually don't make more than this is about 3 liters that this one can contain, 2.5, 3 liters, because you use very, very little each time you apply to a pot, and it's so easy to make, there's no reason to make too much at a time. Then you also need, of course, some water. I already measured the amount of water that I need here. And you need a weight to weight the ball clay, but also you need this glass tube. We're going to use that tomorrow when we adjust the Terra Sigillata, because it's very important that you end up with the right specific gravity for this. The sequence of applying a proper Terra Sigillata is to settle out all the small particles and separate from the heavy ones. And to do that, you need a deflucant. There's different kinds of deflucants you can use. I use sodium silicate, only that. There is, many studies have shown, for reasons nobody appeared to understand, a combination of sodium silicate and soda ash is actually a little bit better. But this works great for me, and I don't have any soda ash at the moment. So I just use sodium silicate. You should be very careful with how much you put in. The first time I made it, I put too little and it didn't work. And you can also put too much and then it doesn't settle the right way. What I found is that somewhere between 0.25% of the weight of the dry materials should be enough. So for this portion, it's just a couple of spoonfuls. It's very, very little. Anyway, let's get on with it. Oh yeah, there's a few more things you need. A mask, because every time we work with dusty particles in pottery, we should protect ourselves. It is not good to inhale. The ball clean itself is not poisoned as such. It's just all these small particles are not good for you to inhale. So when I start to measure it, I will put my mask on. You also need a way to mix it up. I usually just use a whisk. Some people using a blender or something. It doesn't seem to make much of a difference. As long as you're sure there's no lumps in there, you can also put your hand in because it's not poison or anything. So you can easily do that. And in the end, we're also going to use this tube. You may wonder what that's for, but I'll show you tomorrow. The amount, the mix between the clay and the water is also important. What I use is about 1300 grams of ball clay dissolved into 2.6 liters of water. So roughly 1 to 2. So twice as much water as clay. Some people will say that it should be 1 to 3 or 1 to 4. I don't know. This works good for me. Again, you will get many different answers for the right Terra Sigillata if you ask different people. So I'll go along with that. I already measured 2.6 liters of water. It's in the bucket. So now we're just going to measure out 1300 grams of broccoli. So that's it. Just gonna put this aside because it's generally recommended to put the sodium silicate into the water before you add the dry material. It's a little easier to get mixed up. Just to show you how little it actually is, I'm going to measure out the sodium silicate for you here. So I'm just going to use this, reset the scale. And 0.5% or 1300 gram is roughly about 6.5-7 grams of deflucant. So that's it. This is very little. It's only a couple of spoonsful. I usually don't measure it like that. I usually just take two of the caps here, which is almost the same as that. So that should be plenty. So we put it in here. You may just wanna make sure you got everything out. So that's it. Just remember to clean off the tube before you measure your specific gravity tomorrow. So now we're ready to put the dry into the water. So now I just mix it up to make sure that there's no lumps in there. As I mentioned, the ball clay is not a dangerous chemical or anything. It's basically just clay. So you also put your hands in there and make sure that there's no lumps or anything. If there is, they will just settle to the bottom. As I mentioned, sometimes I actually used a blender to make sure that every lump is dissolved. I think in this case it's actually enough just to use this. Yeah. I mean, it's easy to feel it down here if there is any lumps. Now I'm decorating myself. That's what happens. That's why I put clean jeans on. So, yeah. Not clean anymore. So now we have it, and this is sort of a very thin, a thick milk maybe or something like that. Let's see, there's a few lumps left, but not much. does look messy, doesn't it? It is kind of messy. Maybe I should have them here in the middle of my living room, but it was just the easiest place for me to show you on video. So now I'm just going to fill it into my bucket. So, as you see, I've done this before, so it fits perfectly. I put the lid on because I don't want it to evaporate. I want it to just settle. And what you will see over the next day or two, you will see that the heavy particles will settle to the bottom. Up in the top, there's probably going to be, not always, but most often there's going to be some water. And then in the middle, that's where we have the Terra Sigillata. So this is where all the fine particles that is not on the bottom and it's not pure water, that is the Terra Sigillata. And that's what we're going to siphon tomorrow using this one. So the next thing is I need to put it aside for exactly 20 hours. I've seen a lot of tests on how long to put it, and some people get away with it faster, some people longer, but the most scientific studies I've seen say exactly 20 hours is the correct time, and it actually turned out to be really good for me. So I would suggest that you go for 20 hours exactly. The important thing is here that you you place it at a table, somewhere, a shelf, where it can sit and where you can do the finished siphoning. Because once it's settled, you don't want to move this bottle around, because then you're going to mix it up again, and the heavy particles are going to get mixed up in the fine particles, and you don't want that. So put it somewhere where you can also do the siphoning tomorrow. So in 20 hours, it's Friday afternoon now, so tomorrow evening, tomorrow early afternoon, we're gonna do this siphoning. So I'll get back to you with that. Good morning. Now we are ready to siphon the Terra Sigillata, or the mix we made yesterday. It's a bit rainy outside, so it's a perfect day to do this sort of work. It's been exactly 20 hours since we mixed it up, the ball clay, the water, and the deflucant, the sodium silicate, and it's been sitting here on my table undisturbed for 20 hours. So this is my table where the glass has been sitting since yesterday. And below here, I have a empty bucket. So when I open it up, it's even more obvious that the upper part here is pure water. It's only, I would say, maybe half a centimeter, maybe even less. And this middle part is the Terra Sigillata. And down here, oh, you can almost see it. I don't think you can see it on the video, but just around here is the heavy particles. So in other words, we need to stick this down not any deeper than this. I would rather take out too little than too much, because you don't want all those heavy particles or big particles to be part of it. And the ball clay is so cheap. I use standard ball clay and it's very cheap. So it doesn't matter how, if there's a little of the fine particles left down there, rather that than get the big particles, because then it will be less shiny. So I measure it with my hand like this, and this is probably as deep as I will go, and stick it in. And now is the time to suck it and then not get too much in your mouth. Ah, I got something in my mouth. It actually doesn't taste so bad. More like mud. So now it's running out, as you can see here. It's very fluent, which is exactly what it should be. I don't think I will take out more than this. I could probably take a little bit more, but again, it doesn't matter too much. Now I have this, which is the Terra Sigillata. So next step is that we need to measure the specific gravity. So let's go and do that. So now we're back at my kitchen table, my dining table. And I have my my weight here, very precise weight. And I got my glass tube, which I've already measured out for specific gravity. Basically, you can use any kind of tube like this. So basically what you do is that you you put it on your weight and reset it. And then you fill it up with 100 grams of water. And in this case, it's exactly here. So I put this blue tape on it. So now I know that 100 grams of water takes up this much space. So to measure the specific gravity of any fluid, you put it back on your scale, make sure that it's reset, and then you fill it up with your mixture to the exact same point. And the readout that you're gonna get is the specific gravity. So if the readout is 115, then it will be a specific gravity of 1.15, which is what we are aiming for. It's important when you measure it that that you make sure that it hasn't settled. Now I just siphoned it, so it shouldn't be settled at all. And just to make it easier to put into the tube, I'll just put it into this. And of course, it's important that you hit exactly the mark. Now it is exactly 115 grams. So that is 1.15 specific gravity. So now the Terra Sigillata is ready. I don't know if you can see it here, but it's ready and can be applied as it is. The ball clay that I use is pretty white. So if you want that shiny white surface, that in itself is gonna work. But you can also add colorants. If you want it more white, you can add tin or cyclopex, I think it's called, another cheaper kind of whitening. But you can also add colors. The problems with the coloring is that you can use oxides or carbonates, or you can use stains, mason stains or other kinds of colorings. The problem with a lot of these colorings is that the particles are bigger than the very small particles that we have separated for the Terra Sigillata, except for the carbonates and some of the oxides. So if you add cobalt or copper oxide, that should be fine. And that could create a nice blue or greenish color. Of course, you can also mix them. I also use iron oxide, red iron oxide. It also gives nice colors. Of course, when you then pit fire them or rocket fire them, depending on what you do, the coloring may change, so it may not be exactly what you're used to. But you can also use mason stains or other stains. Just be aware that the particles are a little bit bigger. So that means it may not be as shiny as the pure Terra Sigillata is. Also, when you apply it, make sure that you constantly mix it. Ideally, if you use coloring elements like stains, you would put them in a ball mill. A ball mill is like a drum with small balls in it, typically marble or stone or glass or something. And then you can put a material in there and you roll it, typically for many, many hours. And it grinds all these little particles into very, very fine particles. So that way you could use any kind of stain, ball mill it, and it would be very fine particles and you would get the perfect shine and everything. I don't have a ball mill because they're quite expensive. So I do my coloring just usually, I most often been using iron oxide and cobalt carbonate or oxide and copper carbonate. And they tend to blend fine and give a good shine. But I also have a lot of other coloring agents, stains. And for this batch, I will try and experiment with some of them. The coloring that I've been using mostly is a red iron oxide. It is very fine particle and it is very cheap. So you can go crazy with that for almost no money. I also have used here some cobalt stains. So this is not pure cobalt or cobalt oxide. I do also have some cobalt carbonate, but cobalt carbonate and cobalt oxide in its pure form is very expensive. It is more fine particle. I think you could almost see it. At least you can feel it. It is very small particles, so it is probably better to use this if you want to make a very high quality colored Terra Sigillata. But I also have some other colors. One that I picked up recently that I really like is this Turkish colored blue one, light blue one, ocean blue, lighter than ocean blue, I would say. It's a very nice color. Also, I have, of course, I have my copper carbonate, which is a nice green, and I have this that I used for some colored clay, a yellow one, and I also have a red one sitting somewhere. I think I forgot to pick it up from the basement. So I will make just a few of these. I already have a lot of the iron oxide Terra Sigillata in another pot, so I'll put that aside. And I'll try and make some of the other ones. Depending on what kind of stain it is and how powerful the color is, it's typically recommended from the supplier how much to put in. If you look at this yellow, I put it here, optimal 3 to 6. So that means around 3 to 6%. In general, I would say that the lighter colors need more and the darker colors need less. If you look at the cobalt, it's a very powerful coloring. I put optimal 3. This is what the supplier of this particular cobalt stain recommend, maximum 3%. And that is very dark blue in my experience. For the Turkish one, it's 4 to 6%. So depending on what it is, and I would say for the pure cobalt carbonate, it's probably just 1%. So let's try and make that. I use these small glasses. Good thing is that you can close them very tight. So you don't get any of the water evaporating. I do. It's a little difficult with this weight when you have this lid, but it's very easy to take off. And then it just stands here and reset it, and then you're going to put some of the Terra Sigillata in there. I highly recommend that you only make very small batches of it, because if you make a mistake and it's too much or too little, then you can always sort it out and make something new. And also it lasts a long time. I mean, it's a very thin layer you put on. I'll show you that later. So you don't need that much. So again, let's just make sure that it's mixed up here. So we get really fine particles and then measure it out here. So, I think I will start with some of the cobalt stain. I used that before and I know that it works well. So, let's see here. I'm not going to add 3%. This stain is not as strong as carbonate, but I think I will go with 2%. And I will go with 2% of this total weight. So, in other words, it's not, usually you would measure it based on the dry ingredients, but I'm, just for the ease of it, I'm measuring on the total weight of my Terra Sigillata. So 2% is just 2 grams, which is probably something like a spoonful or something. I will see here on the weight. Yep. So it's very, very little. So even if you use the most expensive ingredients, it's still not going to be much. Now, of course, you want to mix it. And don't be fooled, because when you look at this now, it doesn't look very colored. But especially with the cobalt, you can't actually see it. You can't even see it when you apply it, which of course makes it a little bit more complicated. But trust me, when it fires, it does come out quite strong. So that was the first one. Let's put the lid back on here. Oh, that was the wrong way. Yeah. I should edit all this out, but then again, I don't. We always make mistakes. So here we have it. Another thing is that you need to label it because you can't see the color. So it's not enough just to have the glasses. I have this small label printer that I use. If it's working. Yep, it is. But of course you can just write it on. It's just, I like this, it's so easy. So in this case, I wrote, let me show you, TS for Terra Sigillata, cobalt stains, and 2. And the number 2, of course, referred to the fact that I put 2% in it. So I'm going to put that on. Now I'm ready to apply some Terra Sigillata to a few of my pots. I'm going to use the rest of what I already had, so I'm not going to use a new one today. I have one here that I use a lot, that I really, really like. It comes out really nice. It's a combination of iron oxide and the cobalt oxide. And it's 1% of each. So very light, but the coloring of those elements are very strong. So that one I will use. And then I have my uncolored Terra Sigillata, the pure Terra Sigillata. And so I will apply that to the pots. But let's take a look at the pots, because it's important that the pots have the right dryness before you apply it. I have a few pots here that all are gonna get Terra Sigillata on them, because they're all gonna be pit fired. Some tall bottle-like vases, some small ones over here. They need to be completely bone dry when you apply the Terra Sigillata. And one way to check it is to feel it. And that, you know, let me just move this away. Of course, you have to be very careful when you handle the bone dry, unfired, unbisqued ware. But if you put your hand on it, you can feel that if it's cold, there's still some humidity in it. This one have been there for, well, maybe a little more than 2 weeks or something. So that is bone dry. This one, on the other hand, is also warm when you feel it up here. But then when I move down, and typically in the bottom, that's the last part that's gonna dry, you can actually feel the difference. So down here, it feels a little bit colder, and up here, it becomes a little bit warmer. So I'm gonna leave that for a few more days. The first thing that I do when I look at the pot is that I wanna make sure that it's completely smooth. This one I smoothed out a lot when I was trimming it. So it actually is very nice. Sometimes I sand them a little bit. And if you do that, you need to clean them with not a wet sponge, but just damp sponge, because if there's any dust left, those dust particles are bigger than the Terra Sigillata, so they will make very tiny little bumps and it will make it less shiny. So to make it completely shiny, you need a clean surface and a smooth surface. But what you don't want is you don't want to burnish this surface. You can burnish it with like a shiny stone, or yeah, I usually use something like this. But if you do that, you get sort of a hard surface. And in my experience, it makes it more difficult for the Terra Sigillata to stick, and more likely that it will flake off during firing. So you want it to be smooth, but not burnished, not pressed together. It will close it. What I always do, no matter if I grind it or not, is I'm just gonna rub it with a piece of cloth or something to make sure that there's no dust that has settled. It's been sitting there for the better part of 2 weeks or something, so there could be some dust or something. I'm just gonna clean that out. And again, be very careful because it is so fragile, but you probably know that if you already have been working with pottery for some times. I have broken quite a few. So anyway, it's just a little bit of bump there. So now we are ready to apply the Terra Sigillata. For this one, I will apply the dark one, the iron oxide and cobalt on the top, and the white one on the bottom. It will, when we fire it in the pit fire later this summer, it will not be red bluish, but it will get dark. So it will get more, well, I can show you a picture. You can see somewhere here. This is an example of what it can turn out. So I will do a whole firing later, and of course make a video about it so you can see that. So it will be two colored and it will look really nice. So first thing is to center it. Just need to turn it off. Okay. Especially for the top part, it needs to be pretty well centered, otherwise it's difficult to get that line perfect. But that should be easy enough. Yeah, I think that's good. So let me take the first. Another thing that's important when you apply is the kind of brush you use. I found that these kinds of Chinese brushes, I'm not sure what they're called, but these kind of Chinese brushes, they're good because they're very accurate, and also they can still hold quite a lot of the Terra Sigillata, because you don't want to be dipping it all the time. So this one actually holds a lot, and it's also kind of accurate. So I don't know if you can see it here, but Terra Sigillata have settled down here. So some of the heavier particles and some of the oxides have settled in the bottom. But this is also just maybe 100 grams or maybe a little more. It's so little that I can just mix it up with the brush. I don't actually need anything else. I just want to make sure that all the particles are mixed up, and I want to make sure that there's none of the colorants that are sitting at the bottom of the Terra Sigillata. So here we have it. Oh yeah, there's one other thing that we need that will do all the magic. We need a pair of gloves. And these are, I think, polyester gloves. And this is my trick. It's not my trick alone. I think I got it from some other potter, but it's the trick that I use now for polishing or burnishing the pots. If you, like me, mostly do wheel thrown pots, you can do this. If you hand build stuff, then of course you don't have, you can't rotate it the same way that I can do here, but you can still use these gloves, and they're very effective. And you've probably seen some potters that are applying Terra Sigillata and takes forever to burnish it for the right shine. This is super fast. I will show you that in just a second. So now we have the Terra Sigillata ready. Especially when you do two colors, like this is a darker color and this should be a lighter color, you have to be very careful not to drip, because if you drip anything, you're not gonna get it away. So basically what you do is what you get. So I start out very lightly with one coat. Always start at the top. And I don't put too much on. Just a light coat. It's better that it's a little too light than it's too much, because if you get any drips, it will stay there. It won't get away. So it's better to just add a few more coats. I know that some potters will tell you that you should burnish in between each layer. I found that I get better results by not doing that, because again, if you start burnishing between layers, it feels like it's more difficult to get the Terra Sigillata to stick. So I don't let it dry completely, but I make it so it's not too sticky before I apply the next layer. I usually give it 2-3 coats, depending on how
how big it is. But I think for this, especially the colored ones, it's plenty with 2 or 3. So I think that looks good. I think that will be good. Now comes the magic. Put on the gloves. Again, I only give it like a few seconds, 10 seconds maybe or something. You don't want it to be completely dry. You don't of course want it to be completely wet, because then you're just gonna, you know, scratch it out. But something like this. Now comes the magic. Just use your gloves and polish it like this. And this is so easy and actually very comforting, compared to rubbing it with, you know, all kinds of materials. But this is just so super fast. And just touch it very, very lightly, very, very lightly. See how shiny it is now? There's a little bit of a scratch there, but sometimes these small scratches are okay when you do pit fire, because there's gonna be all kinds of crazy things going on anyway. But like the line is very sharp, and see how shiny it is? It's amazing. So sometimes on the edges here, it will break a little bit. It can be difficult to have it stick, especially if you have sharp edges like that. But again, after I do the pit fire, there's all gonna be all kinds of coloring influencing this. So for this kind of pot, it doesn't matter. So take my gloves off, and now ready to do the white Terra Sigillata. So for this part, I'm going to use the same kind of brush, but just in a little bigger version. It holds a little more and I can make more. I just want to make sure, because they are kind of old, these ones, and sometimes these hairs start falling off, and that's okay. I just don't want them to fall off into the application. So now we're ready for the next part. And again, I apply it lightly. Thin layers. The first layer is always a little bit tricky, because that's where you have the completely dry pot, and it takes in so much. But don't be worried. Sometimes when I get to this stage, I start at the bottom and work my way up. And again, for this, it's better that you apply thin layers multiple times than trying to put too much on, because what you don't want is, you don't want any kind of drips, because that's gonna show. And that doesn't look so good. It's okay if you have, depending of course what your goal is, but for what I do with the pit fire, it's okay to have a little bit of stripes and unevenness, but the drips, or the running, is I don't like that. Again, that's just me. So this is two layers, and it definitely needs a little more. I don't know, for some reason I always end up getting it too little at the lower part. You could also, and some potters do that, I also do it sometimes for certain kind of shapes, that you turn it around and put it in a chuck, and then first you do the lower section, and then you turn it around and do the upper section. You can do that too. So, and then the magic gloves. And look how shiny it becomes. It's such a magical feeling. It's funny. I really, really love this. And before I found out I could use the gloves, I was using plastic and other kind of materials, and it just took so much work. And now with the gloves, it's so little work, and it's so nice to do it. And see, now this part is not completely even, there's a little bit of wobbling, but Nobody see that when the wheel stops. So anyway, now it's ready. And look how shiny it is. Now, when you have done this, this beautiful shiny surface is very, very sensitive. So whenever I move around the pots that I have, that I applied the Terra Sigillata to and that I have polished up, burnished, I always move them around with my gloves because finger marks, they actually leave a mark and it's gonna stay there until the end. Especially if you do, yeah, if you do pit fire and even rockwell, I think it's gonna stay, it's not gonna burn off. And I don't like finger marks on my pots. So from now on, even when I move them into the kiln, I'm just gonna move them with my hands. I'm always just gonna turn it and make sure that there's no drips or anything left here. So this is fine and it's ready for the kiln. Actually, I just wanna show you one more thing because as I'm always saying that I'm always experimenting with at least part of the fire, at least part of the pottery I do. When I do my pit fires, there's always something that I'm pretty sure is gonna turn out well. And then there's something that I think might turn out well. And then there's always something totally crazy. And this time I'm gonna do something that I never done before because I'm gonna apply some of the colored Terra Sigillata to this. Yeah. I'll start out with a layer of the basic white, maybe actually two layers, I'll see. But at least one layer of the basic white Terra Sigillata. And then I will try and do some stuff with the colored ones on top of that. And I have no idea how that's gonna turn out, but it may be interesting and especially when it interacts with the combustibles. And more specifically, I'm gonna use some seaweed on this pot. So let's see how that turns out. So first, a layer of the white. I'm just gonna use a big brush for this. It's much faster. So I think that's enough. So for my additional layers, I'm going to brush some interesting patterns. I have this brush that I like a lot. I use that for iron oxides too, when I brush that onto bowls. I could also potentially use some brushes like this. I even have something completely crazy like this one, but it's a little too big for this, but yeah, I could potentially use it. But I think in this case, I'm gonna use this, I don't know what you call it, a fan brush or something. So I have different layers. I think I wanna start with the light ones. And this is the yellow one that we just mixed before. And I'm just gonna shake it good like this. I think that's gonna be helpful. Now it's dripping down my leg, which was not intentionally, but it's still gonna be okay. So yeah, this is nice. Just see. Yeah, I think that's gonna be okay. So I'm just gonna do some. So, I don't think I'll do more of the yellow one. Or maybe something in the top. Something like that. I think that's enough. And then, I wanna try out my red one. I should of course be cleaning this, but there's so little color in it that I don't think that's going to be a problem. Yeah. I think actually I was thinking about using some of the blue, but now I'm not sure about that. Do you think I should make the top maybe blue? I think maybe I will make the top blue. And for that, I'm just gonna use this. And as I mentioned, when I mix this, you can't really see the color of cobalt before you fire it, and after the first fire, it's probably usually not so distinct. So yeah, something like that, I think. And now for the magic gloves. And the final burnishing, let's see how that's going to shine up. As I mentioned, these stains and not so much the cobalt stain, but the red and the yellow stain it's not mason stains, but it's still, you know, same kind of stain, and the particles are a little bigger, so it may not be as shiny. Yeah, you can kind of see it here. It is not quite as shiny as the uncolored one, but still, I think after firing and I will polish it with either a wax or acrylic spray, so I think it's still gonna be okay. Yeah, sometimes it jumps around a little bit, just be careful. It is very fragile at this point. So, I think that will be interesting. Especially when it blends with the combustibles, the seaweed and stuff. So, that's it. I will do the rest of the pots in a day or two or something when they are completely bone dry. And then I will put it in my basement for at least a day or something, so I'm sure that it's completely dry. And then I'm ready to bisque fire it. The bisque firing is also important. Of course, it needs to be fire to the right temperature for the clay that you're using. I fire this to 950 degrees centigrade, which is perfect for this kind of clay. And it's also good for the Terra Sigillata. Of course, you could bisque fire it higher, but the higher you bisque fire it, on a microscopic level, these little particles are being broken down in a way that makes it less shiny. So the lower temperature you can get away with for whatever clay you're using, the better for the shininess. 950 degrees have proven to me to be perfect for this kind of clay, but again, you need to test that with your own clay. I will get back to you here on the channel later this summer with a video about how I use all these pots with the applied Terra Sigillata and also all the combustibles that I collected on this small little island in Fire. There's a link to that video if you want to see that. And I will do a whole firing just with the natural combustibles. That's going to be interesting to see how that goes. Of course, in combination with the Terra Sigillata and all. So if you like this video and if you want to see more, please subscribe and like and share. If you have any comments, any questions about my methods, or I will try and answer the best I can. So I hope to see you soon again, and have a good summer.